Hello, everyone. Welcome to The Grid Live. I'm Mia McCormick here with Pete Collins. We don't look like your regular hosts. We look a little bit different, right? But we're not going to talk about this situation in the middle yet. We're going to get to this in just a second. Pretend like you have no idea what's going on here right now, right, Pete?
Yep.
I'd like to be called the irregular host.
The irregular host. So Scott and RC aren't here, obviously. RC is actually out in Dubai. He's teaching at Golf Photo Plus. And Scott is headed that way. He's in San Francisco at the moment. He's at Adobe headquarters having meetings with them there. But he is actually headed to Dubai. They're going to like cross each other. Right? And he's accepting an international photography award there. It's known as the HIPAA Award. And the theme of the competition is Life in Color, and it's for his contribution in photography education. So congratulations, Scott. Yep, there's the Woo-hoo! Website there.
Congratulations.
That's pretty cool. I wish Kelly Ripa would give him the HIPAA Award. But that's just me. That's just me.
So I've heard, rumor has it, that it'll be the first time that he has worn a tux since he was married. So
that's going to be awesome.
Can't wait to see those photos. That'll be interesting.
I'm going to definitely tell Brad, because Brad's going over there with him, so Brad better have some great behind-the-scenes shots.
The beard will be in Dubai?
The beard will be in Dubai.
And so RC's there now teaching, and he has this awesome photo that he just put on his blog right now. I love the purple sky in that shot. It's the Grand Mosque in Abu Dhabi. Amazing shot there. Loving that.
Fantastic.
He's having a great time out there.
Shh, we haven't introduced you. You can't say
so this
anything.
Is what, I'm let's not here. Talk about what's going on in the middle, Pete, right? Let's talk about what all this goodness is right here.
Well, it's been a whirlwind of activity today because we have had Matthew Jordan Smith in here all day. We've done photography TNT. We've done all these product segments and stuff, and we've just been blessed to have him in here in the studio today, and we had to get him on the grid. If you don't know who he is, you will by the end of this show, and you definitely need to go check him out. He is Matthew Jordan Smith at MatthewJordanSmith.com, celebrity photographer. Got a brand new book out that we're going to talk about later that is phenomenal. This is a guy you need to know, so make sure you check him out. How are you doing, Matthew?
I'm doing pretty good. It's good to be here.
We're
here
so
in Tampa, Florida. Loving it.
Yeah, we heated up the weather for you. Just
I know.
Bit.
I
he walked
that.
Out for lunch humidity, and went, whoa.
And I got on all black, but it's great still.
So celebrity, beauty, fashion, that's really where your home is. Tell us a little bit about how you got started in that.
Well, it's funny. It kind of just happened to me. I was this kid who loved photography and go to art school in Atlanta, trying to find, you know, my home. And ended up going to New York and being an assistant. And as an assistant, I found my passion. And it was photographing people. And that led to photographing women. And women led to photographing beauty. And then beauty turned into shooting celebrities for covers. And that's kind of my world now, shooting celebrities, fashion, beauty, portraits. So I guess you could say I'm a commercial photographer.
Okay, well, celebrities run a really wide range, right?
It does.
And I mean,
it does.
But you have shot the top, the A-listers. Like, who is your number one that you just are like, I still can't believe that I was able to photograph this person?
Well, if any of them are watching right now, all of them.
right.
But, no, I photograph everybody from Oprah to the richest man in the world, Carlos Slim, and everybody in between. And I love it every day.
So, what was it like with Oprah?
It's always great with Oprah.
Every
single
great with
shoot.
Oprah.
I mean,
that's what I say.
I've been shooting her since 95, 94, and every shoot is special.
Nice.
Everybody,
well, I have a moment of silence
going,
for Oprah.
Yeah.
Nice. Well, it's not always like that with everybody.
Right.
But,
so then what is the biggest challenge of working with an A-lister like that? Is it time? Because that's what everybody says, is you have a list a little bit of time with them. And then,
it is time. And when I first shot her in the 90s, I'd have her all day long. And then as the years progressed on, it'd be like, you know, oh, you have her for like 2 hours, and you have her for like 15 minutes. Mm-hmm. So now my challenge is making sure that everything's set up, ready to go, and that I can keep her there as long as I can. And the secret to doing that is really having great music and making her feel amazing on the set. That way, I can keep her longer, where her people try to pull her out and say, Oprah, come on, we gotta go. But she's staying there.
So music plays a big part of it, then.
Well, also,
or,
I would say music and food.
Music and food, but definitely music is a special thing. It gets everybody in the mood, you know?
So do you play what you like or what you think they would like?
What I think they would like. At times, or I'll play music that I think that we all feel good about. Imagine going to karaoke. And you hear this song you haven't heard in a long time. You just had this connection with it. So I do that.
Smart.
I play memories of music.
Well, and one of the things that everybody talks about, the more you check into his life and his work and all, is they talk about how personable and how interested he is in the person he's shooting.
You have to be.
And what it is the way I say it is he has spent the time to research that person to show them that he values that person. And that is, I think that is the thing that keeps coming back. You value the people you shoot, and that feeds into it. So you're playing their music. You even have, sometimes you'll have a chef cooking the food that creates
Absolutely.
That environment, because you're really serving them the way you're valuing them. And in response, they respond to you, and you get shots that nobody else can.
But it's funny, you know, I just did this job a year ago where I photographed 75 directors in China, and many of my subjects couldn't speak English. So I'm trying to find that connection anyway. And I learned doing that assignment that it's the feeling in the room. Mm-hmm. Even if you can't communicate in the same language, it's this feeling in the room that everybody feels, and it causes this connection.
Hmm. So how did you really gravitate towards that end of the industry as opposed to anything else? I mean, were you always interested in shooting portraits and shooting people?
Absolutely. I think it just found me. I think, you know, for photographers, you find what you love. And for me, I love being around people and that connection. And the image is the byproduct of having a great time on set. But it's that connection with people and finding that moment. I'm looking for special moments on every photo shoot, regardless of who it is, whether it's a child or it's a celebrity. It's that connection, that moment, and freezing that moment in time forever.
So have you been, tell me about an instance where you couldn't get that connection.
Oh,
what do you do?
What do you do? You're not always successful all the time. Mm-hmm. That's life. Mm-hmm. But you try everything you can in your arsenal to pull out and get a person to connect with you. It doesn't always work. It's not supposed to always work. But if you're successful 90% of the time, that's pretty good. I mean, imagine a baseball player having that kind of connection, you know.
Yeah, that would be great.
Well, I was going to say, do we have his website queued up? I'd love to let some people who might not know who he is see a few of his images to kind of, yeah, there we go. Let's go over to some of the celebrity stuff.
We're going to talk about that coming up, that future American president.
But if we can just scroll through a
few
of
these. That's a surprise coming up a little later in the show.
Give some ideas of some of the work that you're doing. You know, I asked you earlier, I said, Queen Latifah looks like she would just be a joy to work with.
Well, Queen Latifah is a joy to work with. She is so much fun. The shot on the very far right is the first time I photographed her. And then the shot on the left, the poster for her show was shot recently. But there's a lot that has happened in between those two images. It's a whole life that's happened in between those two images. And we just have a lot of fun every time we shoot. We have great music. We have connection with the whole team, hair, makeup. Aretha Franklin, I've been shooting her for like the last 10 years. There's Oprah right there. It's just a matter of having connections with people and at the same time, you know, enjoying it all.
I was going to say, that would be pretty cool to be able to go shoot them again, and almost like you have a memory box of your time with
them. It's funny you say that, memory box, because people see these images that are on my website. Mm-hmm. They see that the whole world sees, you know, a cover of a magazine or whatever is published. But there's this other part that nobody ever sees. It's behind the scenes on a shoot. And I start giving my clients these gifts of little books that are done behind the scenes, the making of.
Mm.
And it's so special because it takes you back to that day, that moment, and all the other stuff happening around. And that's very cool.
So do you have somebody with you shooting just that stuff?
Sometimes I have a timeless camera going off, shooting behind the scenes. Oh. I have an intern sometimes taking pictures, but usually it's a time-lapse camera that's taking pictures behind the scenes.
That's a great idea.
It's very cool.
I noticed some pictures of Tyra Banks, and I know you've been hooked up with America's Next Top Model.
Yes, I have.
And you were a judge, right?
I've been a judge four times. I've been on the show five times.
Okay, how did that connection happen?
I started shooting Tyra back in the early 90s. Okay, 90s. I shot it back in the 90s.
Late 90s.
Back when she was just a up-and-coming model and an up-and-coming photographer. We started testing together all the time, and that friendship has lasted all these years. Now we're like texting each other all the time. So, and in between, you know,
steal
things happen.
Steal his phone when he leaves.
I'm
going to pickpocket him while he looks that way. He's got his contact list in his phone.
It's
probably
no idea
we could sell that for a lot of money, couldn't we?
But it's funny because I think back to those days. I photographed Tyra at the beginning of her career, Heidi Klum at the beginning of her career, and seeing them both evolve.
The reason why they've become as
well.
Way to go. Well done. I want to go back to the whole thing. I think this is fascinating. It's just, we as photographers get so caught up in the technical. And what
Absolutely.
You're saying is that what has been one of the biggest reasons for your success is you've tapped into the emotional.
It's always that. Yes, you have to have the chops, period, as a photographer. But in terms of getting work and having a career, you know, decade-long career, it's about the connection with your clients and your subjects. Not just being great with the camera. That's a small part of it. That's the fun part.
Right.
There's a whole other world around that.
Well, and I think that we try to talk about what it takes to make it. And so many people focus on the, I know the Fs.
The buttons, the dials.
Everybody
does. The dials and all that. I know how to light this, that, or the other. But the truth of the matter is, I keep going back to the statement that Peter Hurley made. He's 10% photographer and 90% counselor.
Absolutely. I get that. Absolutely.
And so your skill, because let's face it, these folks that you're shooting are dealing with people all the time.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody's coming wanting something, and they're used to, they probably have a big BS filter, you know, see who's coming at them. Some do, some don't. Some are big BSers themselves. But to see somebody that comes in and gets it,
mm-hmm.
and gets them, I bet you that really puts a little mark in the head like, yeah, I like this guy. And so when they get a choice on something, they're going to come back to you.
Yes, but very often I'm shooting jobs for clients. Say it's for an ad. So then you're dealing with a lot more people. You're talking about, you know, advertising agency with art buyers and producers. It's just another world. And then the celebrity is just the subject for that product. So it's another thing altogether that people don't really think about. A big part of being a commercial photographer is really being a director, producer.
Well, and how many people will you have to deal with on a commercial shoot like that could either help or derail the shot?
Last week, there were 35 people on the set.
Oh, my gosh.
That was crew.
That you have to direct while you're out there doing
Absolutely.
Your thing.
Absolutely.
So you have
the
to
shooting part's the easy part.
You have to really take command. I mean, when
Absolutely.
You step in, you have to be...
You have a different hat on.
Wow.
You're running the show.
Let's take a question because we have a couple of comments coming in. This one's from Jim Kearns. It says, you demonstrate such control of light in your portraits. Is there any one factor that you attribute to your skill with lighting to? Schooling, a mentor?
Absolutely. That's a great question. And thank you, Jim, for that question. I think in terms of lighting, I fell in love with the art of light as an assistant. I worked for this guy named Neil Barr. Neil Barr worked for Bazaar back in like the 60s, 70s. But I learned a lot about light. Actually, I learned how to see light.
What do you mean by that?
Because we all see light, obviously, but you don't really see the nuances of light until you study it. The small different changes by moving a light 1 inch or up or down, just a millicron.
I'm familiar with that term of
millicron.
Measurement. Yeah,
just a millicron. And it makes a big difference. When you start seeing that change, that small change in either the angle or the distance, then you're getting there. And I learned that from working with Neil Barr. He was a great photographer. He worked for Irving Penn, and I learned by studying under him. And I'm still studying all the time and learning all the time. You never stop.
It's funny you say that because a lot of people think of you at the very top. You're at the very top of the game. Well, the people that you're photographing and the ads that you're doing, you know, I mean, big names we're talking about. What would you say is the most limiting factor? And this is, I'm getting this from a question that Jim has also asked, Jim Kearns, asking full of good
thanks,
questions
Jim.
Today,
thanks,
Jim. Thanks for watching. What do you think is the most limiting factor for people who want to break into this business? What do they have to overcome?
Not understanding that it's not just about photography. I think the idea that thinking that you just have to be a great photographer is the secret to having success in this industry, it's not. It's much more than that. I think the secret is learning how to work with people on a large scale, learning how to be able to direct, to communicate your thought visually. And also, like, if you're up for this big ad, being able to tell people how you want to bring to life verbally as well. It's all communication. That's the single biggest, I think, hurdle.
Well, I also appreciated in your blog you were talking about overcoming or persevering or pushing through. That nowadays we want that instant gratification and everybody changes so often. But
absolutely.
Could you speak to that for a second?
Oh, definitely, definitely. I think there are always challenges in your life and in your career. And I think that's the universe testing you to see how badly you want something, be it in your career, whatever. You're going to be challenged at points. And as a photographer, you're challenged all the time. It can be on a daily basis. Every job is a challenge in some way. Where something doesn't work right, be it the gear or technical, there's always something that's going to go wrong. It's you learning how to problem solve on the spot all the time. I think the commercial photographer is always working with overcoming some hurdle on every single job. Because it always happens. It could be, you know, your client, it could be the gear, it could be technical, it could be anything. But you're always overcoming some hurdle.
Well, and I would think that how you carry yourself while you're overcoming that hurdle can be a big deal.
Absolutely. Absolutely. It is. That's in life, period, as well.
Yep. Well, and that's how you get booked again, right?
Yes, yes. And the secret to having a career is being booked over and over again by the same clients. Yes, for sure.
Exactly. I'm looking at, you see, Mike Cabasi's up there. He's a great Hollywood photographer, friend of ours, fellow instructor here at Kelby One. And even he has a question for you.
Yes, yes.
He wants to, do you know Mike?
I don't. But hi, Mike, how you doing?
He wants to know about your studio. Do you have your own studio?
I don't have my own studio. I'm always renting. I shoot Milk Studios in L.A. and New York all the time. It feels like home, but it's not my studio. I always rent studios. I lived in New York for 26 years, and I always rented studios there. And same in L.A., I'm always renting in a space. It's just having booking the right space for the right job.
Got it. I was thinking a little bit about, and just a part of this, me being a woman and thinking about the idea of beauty when you're a beauty and fashion photographer. I wonder, you personally, how the industry has molded what your idea of beauty is.
Oh, that's
or what you have to
question.
Show.
That's a very good question. I take pictures all over the world, and there's a different idea of what beauty is everywhere in the world, be it in India or Japan or America or even New York and LA. It's a different idea of what beauty is. As a photographer, you're hired for your vision. And that's showing how you feel. It should be. It's part of you putting your fingerprint on all your work. Early in my career, I didn't get that. You know, I go into a meeting for a magazine, and they're like, oh, what kind of models do you like to photograph? I'm like, any model. But it's really, they want to find out how you feel. What's your take on beauty? What's your take on the world? What's your take on how you view the world through your pictures, be it fashion or portraits or whatever? It's you having your single vision on how you feel about all that, beauty, the world, politics, whatever. But you're saying it through your medium, photography. And mine is fashion, beauty, entertainment.
So I'm thinking then some advice would be, if you're looking to break into this business, make sure you know your vision, have that set.
Make sure you have a very clear vision of how you see the world.
Right.
And then be true to that vision all the time. Make sure you're always telling the world how you feel about what you're shooting. Forget about what Abbas is doing. Think different. Think about how you feel and put your thumbprint on all your work.
Who did you like working with the best?
Celebrity-wise, yeah, or model-wise?
No, celebrity-wise. Who would you think
Oh, wow. There's a lot. I have an affinity for working with Tyra Banks, of course, and Vanessa Williams. It's always a lot of fun working with both of them. Oprah as well. But it's really women. I love working with women a lot.
Oh, you could say that again, please, because wow, that sounds wonderful. A man that loves working for women. This is great. We're going to have one again.
And good, all of a sudden, good. Oh, look, it's a break time now.
Oh, is it time for a break? Yeah. Already? Okay.
We just got started.
I know. That's how I go. Look, it's time for a break. Look, she's got it up there.
I know. I see it.
Hey, but, you know, we're gonna come back and talk about this some more, but the great thing is that we're going to get even deeper into some of the stuff that, you know, you've just got a depth that we've enjoyed talking with all day long, so we could go on forever. But we're going to take a quick break, and we're going to
talk about some of the Kelby One classes that you can see right now that we have. So we want to take a minute just to say check out A Real Wedding. It's live and uncensored with Cliff Montner. These are just released. It's awesome. Okay. I mean, even Cliff says this is the best class that he's done with us. If you're into wedding photography, this guy, he just goes, we go to a real live wedding shoot and he shows you how it's done. He walks you through the process of what he does to capture it. So it's a lot of fun.
He came back and I said, Cliff, how'd it go? And he said, I think this is my best class yet.
Yeah.
And he's had some amazing classes here. So that's pretty good. Pretty good word from him to check it out if you're a wedding photographer or just want to know how to deal with a real live chaotic situation. He dealt with it there, so make sure you check it out.
And then we also have Photoshop's Top 25 webinar going on. Sign up for that. You can do that at the website there on your screen. That's going to be Thursday, next Thursday. And it was for these guys. I mean, the Photoshop guys are, I mean, is there anybody that knows Photoshop better than you guys? No. I mean, there isn't.
Yes.
No, there's not. No.
That's right.
They're going to give you their top 25 tips and things that they do, techniques that they use in Photoshop.
And that's going to be March 19th. As you saw on the timer, it's 8 days away. So make sure you sign up so you can get your spot ready for that, and we're going to have a great time talking about Photoshop. It's 25 years old. It happened Wow. The same time, the same year I was born. It's amazing.
And we'll be back on that note.
Crickets on that one. All right, we'll be right back, guys. Take care.
Hey, guys. Scott Kelby here, and I want to invite you to a very special celebration. As you may know, Adobe's flagship program, Photoshop, turns 25 years old this year. And to celebrate RC, me, and the Photoshop guys, we're hosting a webinar where we'll be showing you the top 25 things you need to know, some hidden secrets in Photoshop, and some of the coolest things that have been added over these years. Now, please come and join us March 19th at 7 p.m. Eastern Time for a whole lot of fun as we celebrate Adobe Photoshop's 25th anniversary. We'll see you there.
President. Oh, we're back. I'm sorry. You know, I'm just filling him on our celebrity stuff because, you know, I don't know where I was going with that. I was trying to be funny, but it was funnier in my head. You ever have that happen?
All the time, actually.
Yeah, no, of course not. You're dead on the money every time, and that's why we love you.
Look at him, of course.
I know.
How long have you been in this business?
28 years now.
So you'd say in 28 years, how many photos do you think you've taken?
Oh.
This list, a random guess. Like, you know, how many beans are in the jar? How many photos are in your...
7.2 million.
Whoa.
Yes.
No. Yeah.
So
It's been a lot.
I would have to say that it would be tough to organize all of those photos. Is that correct?
Until recently, it would be impossible.
Nice segue there.
I know that you work with Mylio, and I've seen some of the stuff that you've done with them. And from everything I've heard, it is just an amazing program. Can you talk about it a little bit for us?
Let me tell you about this program. Before Mylio, it was hard being organized because I'd have pictures on this hard drive or that hard drive or that CD, or it was just, they were everywhere. I thought I was organized, but if I had a call to pull out an image from 2 years ago or whatever, it would take some searching to find that image. I'm like, okay, I know it's on this hard drive, but where in that hard drive? Where in that 2 terabyte hard drive is that one image? Now with MyLeo, that's the thing of the past. Because now with MyLeo, I can have all my images all together on all my devices. I can get a call while I'm in a taxi in New York City, and that's like saying, oh, we're looking for this image. I can pull out my iPad, pull up my images, and find that image. And it's great. It's helped me find things that I've forgotten about. But it's more than just organization. It's backup. It's also, and this is what was a big surprise for me, it was a way for me to remember my life in a way I've never seen before. Because you do a job, but you don't think about it being, you know, your life in pictures until you see it on a screen. Before, we've only had a way of looking at pictures through folders. Mm-hmm. MyLeo gives you several options to look at your pictures, like albums, of course, is kind of similar to folders, but what I fall in love with is the calendar view.
Can we see that? Can you give us an example of what this is?
Because I can. So,
I've heard people say this about the
calendar
program.
View, it's so amazing. So I can go back through and look at my pictures and, you know, go back in time and see where I was on a certain month and what I shot. You know, I can go through and see what I shot in December 13th of 2013, December 2012. It's just a great way for me to go through and see all my life in pictures. And it's incredible because when you do that, you discover things that you've forgotten about. I've discovered images that I've totally forgotten about. I'm like, oh, wow. And then you go down the search on memory lane by going back and remembering those moments. And, you know, I do a job, and very often, like the picture of, say, Tyra, for example, I see that one image. It's the billboard, it's the poster, it's the cover, and you live that image in your mind. But that day, I may have shot 2,000 pictures on the actual shoot, and then there are always other pictures that are behind the scenes pictures, which are what I really love. You're reliving that moment. Imagine that going back 10 years, 20 years, and seeing all those images of people who may not even be here. I had a shoot with Queen Latifah, and I'm looking at the images and looking back at the behind the scenes pictures, and the makeup artist had passed away. I'm like, oh my God, I forgot about that. It's just, it's triggering a way to remember that we've never had before.
And this is something just that's totally separate that I've noticed with MyLeo, because I'm listening to you and I'm looking at your face right now. And I've talked to a couple of other people, you know, Tamara and a couple of other people that work with MyLeo. And this is the one thing that they all come back to. Because a lot of people say, well, what's the difference between MyLeo and Lightroom?
Oh,
But these are questions that you hear all the time.
This program hits on an emotional level that nothing else comes close to. Hmm. You see your work, your body of work, in a way that we've never seen before. Or even like, you know, there's a location view. We can see pictures in different locations, like shots done in, you know, in Thailand or in Japan or in the North Pole or in Sweden. You can see things based on locations, and this is incredible. It's a great way to see your life in pictures.
Well, what I say is it's kind of like a visual time capsule.
Absolutely. It's a great way to put it. It's a time capsule.
And I could see that. Well, as we were talking earlier, I could see it. You can start to see kind of how your life ebbs and flows. It's almost a document or a visual diary of where you've been and what you've done.
What you've done with your life.
And it can also inspire you on when you realize, you look back, oh, the last 2 years, I was really productive these times, and I was
and
down
these months.
And this month,
I haven't done anything.
Yeah, so I need to get busy. Or if you realize that this is going to be the busy month, maybe I need to prepare some stuff for that month or this month. I just think it's a wonderful way to look at your life, because as photographers, we tend to be visual people.
We are, absolutely.
And we're also emotional creatures as well. And so what a wonderful way to look at what you've done and where you could go.
No, I think once you use MyLeo one time, you'll be hooked. It'll change the way you see your photography. It'll change the way you see your life.
About how many images can it hold? What are we talking about here?
I haven't heard the top number so far. On my home device, I have a little less than 500,000 so far. But I've got a lot more to upload, obviously, into the program. But I've got a lot in my machines.
500,000, that's a lot. Now, you organize, you can view your images, can you edit them? What else can you do?
You can edit as long as you have an original. I tend not to keep an original on my laptop and my iPad for travel-wise. Actually, on the small one, I don't keep originals. But as long as you have an original on, you can edit. Or even having a preview, you can edit as well. So you have thumbnails, you have previews, and you have originals. Mm-hmm. And you just select what you want to have on all your devices.
Well, so let's bring it practical. So how would you use it? You live in California.
Yes.
Let's say you get a job in New York.
Yes.
Okay, you go shoot that job. Now what would the process look like? How would MyLeo be involved in that?
So then when there's downloading the pictures into MyLeo. Mm-hmm. So let's say I get that job in New York, and I got to fly back that night to L.A., or that day to LA, I can have my iPad on the plane and start making selections of my favorite shots on the plane, which for me is the most time-consuming part, because I'll ship out all my other parts, like the retouching is done by a professional retoucher. But the editing, finding that one shot, which to me is the most daunting task. Say if I shoot 2,000 images for a cover shoot, I gotta send my client my favorite shots. It's going through and finding those favorite shots. And once I do that, I'm done. So on the plane, which was normally 5 hours, 5.5 hours of just traveling or taking it easy or reading a book, I'm now spending that time to edit and find my top images. And once I set them on my one device, it makes the same selections on all the devices.
Which, so you're already ready to rock and roll once you get back.
I'm saving time.
And speak to the whole idea. You use the word editing. And there's kind of a misnomer there. That speak to that, because we talked about that a little bit earlier.
Yes. It's funny. I think so. The word "edit" in different industries means a different thing. If I'm speaking at a photo convention and I use the word "edit," people are thinking I'm talking about retouching. In the commercial world, if I say "edit," they're not thinking retouching. They're thinking making the selection process.
The culling process.
Exactly.
Yeah, and so when you're saying you're doing the editing, you're going in there, you're rating, you're choosing the best ones, you're deciding which ones to reject.
Absolutely.
And do all that. You're not, you could, you know, sit there and do the post-processing there if you wanted to. But
well, actually, I don't want to do that. I want to use the best person in the industry to do that. So I'm always sending things out to the best people. I can do Photoshop here and there for sure, of course, and a little light editing, but it's not the best.
Right.
I want to hire the best to do that.
And that answers one of the questions people yep. were wondering in the chat as well, if you retouch your own images.
Absolutely not. I'm a photographer, and I love taking pictures. I love the process of being in front of a person and getting that moment, freezing that moment. That's what I want to do all the time. My retoucher is the best at that, and they live for that. I don't. At all.
Does it matter what format your images are in to upload to MyLeo?
I'm shooting different cameras. I'm shooting Hasselblads. I'm shooting Sonys. I'm shooting Nikons. I'm shooting film sometimes. The job I shot in China, I shot 8x10 film.
Wow.
That's hard to get that film in the computer, I'm just going to say.
Well, you just like you slide it in.
Yeah. So the Polaroid slot.
The right. So you just download. You scan for skim. You're scanning the film and putting it in. With digital, of course, you're just downloading the film into MyLeo. It's pretty simple. You use the import button.
Yeah, I think it'll basically handle just about anything you throw at it.
Absolutely. It's very cool. It's getting better and better with each different, change or update.
And as far as somebody asked Sean asked if there's an upper limit to how many images you can upload, I think there's a limit as far as you buy your package for how many you can upload, but I think there isn't necessarily a limit.
We haven't seen the limit yet.
I haven't hit the ceiling of it. It just comes
down
to what
you can
handle.
We're all trying to see what we can handle, but we haven't seen that yet.
Yeah. Is there a file race to see who can
there is,
crack
there
the
is.
Top of
we're trying to find who can put the most in
awesome.
Right now. And so far, I'm not sure who's leading, but
That's awesome. Nice. Hey, I got 600,000 in there.
I got 6.2 million.
Yes. That's cool.
Well, I want to get to, I'm so excited about this book. And I really want to talk about it. Should we do it after the break?
We're going to need to take one more break before we get to these.
I think because we're talking a lot about what happens in the industry, what happens on the set, but I think that there's something to be said for what happens personally.
And absolutely.
What drives you to do personal projects and really stick with them, right? Because in your life, what matters most?
Yeah. Well, also, I think you see this with almost every photographer we bring on here. There's a passion that goes on there. You can see as he's talking, there's passion. And one of the things you got to do, just like he says, he sets the stage and environment for his clients when he's shooting for them. He also realizes that there's an important thing taking care of his own internal passion. So that he can be who he needs to be. So we're going to talk about that in just a minute. But we also got a couple other things we're going to kick out there. You definitely need to check out. Corey's got a brand new class on Kelby One called The Best of Down and Dirty from 2014 with Corey Barker. He's taken some of his favorite Down and Dirty stuff and giving you some wonderful lessons on how he's done that, let you work right along with him. Corey is just the Photoshop master. He's the one that actually should hook up with, with you to do all his stuff. And so make sure you check that out. And that's definitely one thing that we want to promote is every week we've got new classes coming out on Kelby One.
All right. So more about this project, this personal project, this book, Future American President. You don't want to miss it. It's really cool when we come back.
You'll never have fewer digital images than you have today. By tomorrow, you'll have more.
This is the first time in my life where I've had this instantaneous access to all my images all the time.
With Mileo, you look over at your iPad and it's there, and you pop up your iPhone and it's there. It's like, cool.
You're talking about protecting and monitoring the visual history of our lives. This is exactly what I've been waiting for. This is what a ton of people are waiting for. This is what we need.
Welcome back. I guess I'm bringing this one in.
Yeah, we got
We're it. Here with Matthew Jordan Smith. We've talked about clients. We've talked about A-listers. We've talked about big campaigns like you've done L'Oreal and Olay and, you know, big major clients. But now I want to talk about something very personal to you.
Yes.
This book, Future American President. It's not your first book.
No, it's my third, but the one I'm most passionate about.
And I want you to tell me the idea behind it and how you got started with it, because I think this is really cool.
Well, for me, it's personal because I'm a photographer today because of a book. Early on in my career, actually before my career, when it was just like, this thing, photography, somebody gave me a book by Gordon Parks, and that book inspired me to become a photographer as a career. My father turned me on to photography, but that book turned me on to it as a career. So I learned from that experience that influencing a child early on makes a big difference.
So that book made you believe you could do it?
Absolutely. Because I saw a person who looked like me doing something that I dreamed of doing, but I had no idea I could do it as a career until that moment of seeing that person in the book doing that. Then it was real. So for that reason, I wanted to do a book that could inspire children, all over the country, to believe that anything is possible. And I chose to use what I do, photography, to be that tool, that way of teaching children that anything is possible if you just believe.
So you had this idea. Can we show some of the images from the book up here? And you basically, you went around the country, right?
Yes.
I mean, you did this yourself. You had no funding, right?
Nope, not until later into the project, but the book is called Future American President, and I went to every state in the country and found strangers to photograph. I asked parents to let me photograph their children. On the spot, they had no idea who I was from the man on the moon. I walk up to them and ask them, do you believe that your child has the ability to become the president one day? That's how I approach each person.
That takes first, guts.
It does.
Can I just say that takes, coming from a days when I was a reporter, and I know what it's like to walk up to somebody that you don't know and ask
Stressful.
Them a question.
Well, especially to ask parents if you can photograph children.
Yes.
Okay, this. If you go back that one picture for a second of the, so I go all the places and I'd find families on vacation or doing family-oriented things. This family was having, you know, was camping out. And I approached them and asked them, can I photograph their children? And it was strange in the moment. And I always felt vexed about each couple or family that I approached. But I remember the father approaching me, and the father was a policeman. It's actually two families together. And they were asking me, you know, all these questions, and they wanted to find out who I was. And I started talking about other projects and talking about my second book, which was Lost and Found, that I worked with the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children on. So I show these other books that I had with me. I tell them what I'm doing. And they're like, this is a great idea. And then they open up, and then next thing I know, I'm photographing a child, and they're in the book. And then I'm off to the next state.
But you had to think about that beforehand, right? I mean,
Absolutely.
There was like a whole thought process of approaching somebody and what they would need to feel comfortable.
Yes, I thought about what would make me feel comfortable about a stranger approaching me, wanting to photograph my child. And so I thought, okay, I'd have to know the person was, number one, sane, not crazy, not a stalker. And also, they had the ability to make what they are doing come to life. So I wanted to show my other books, wanted to show my career visually. So I took examples of my work, celebrities. I took examples of the two books that I had before and told them the idea, my big idea.
And it takes money to make something like this work,
it
right?
Does.
You don't
it
just
does.
Have this idea. Everybody can walk around with all these ideas in your head, but to actually see it come and be print and bound and tangible in your hands, there's some cash flow that has to happen.
Oh, yes, yes. And that was definitely my stress for a long time. The first year of doing the project, I did it on my own, and it was hard. It was stressful.
How hard?
The first 32 states you went, the first 32 states you went to, you were all self-funded, right?
Self-funded. I travel a lot for business. Mm-hmm. So I'd use my miles, I'd scrape and I'd you know, cut corners everywhere I could. I'd go back home and do a job, go back out and stay out for like 3 weeks. Go back again, do a job, go out again. So all my money was going into the book. I took money from my retirement account actually to do this book even.
Wow.
Because it was passionate for me. And then the second year, I did Kickstarter. And I raised money to finish the book doing Kickstarter.
So tell me how that worked for you. Because I know a lot of people, I've seen people kind of put their dreams. It was like a way, a lot of people thought of it as a harness, it just is something to get one thing done. But it's a way to make like your dream come true.
Absolutely, absolutely. It's funny, when I first did Kickstarter, I had no idea about Kickstarter. One of the parents approached me and said, Matthew, you should use Kickstarter. And I started doing research into it. I'm like, okay, wow, you know, I'll try this. At first, I was against it because I didn't want to put the project out there yet in a big way. But then I had no choice because I was out of money and I had to. And I went to Kickstarter and it was the best thing I ever did because it opened the project up to the whole world, not just the country, to the world. I had supporters from all these different countries coming in, you know, Sweden, Japan, Iceland even. Who all believed in the project and wanted to be a part of it. As a matter of fact, I had a group in Switzerland, in Geneva, who loved the project so much, they took pictures of 100 French children, or, you know, Swiss children, and had them all holding signs in French about being future presidents and sent it to me.
Hmm. Wow.
Because they saw the project on Kickstarter.
So let me ask you, and I want you to be honest. Do you think that your who you are and your celebrity, how much of a role did that play in you getting the money through Kickstarter? Can your average Joe do this?
Yes, because the celebrity part didn't play any part into...
Well, your name holds weight.
Well, I was going to say...
I'm not sure if I'm a celebrity, though.
Well, but credibility-wise, people said this isn't just a fly-by-night thing. But I think there could also be a side note to that is a lot of people, as soon as they see you're a celebrity photographer, whatever, they're assuming you're rich, you're knocking it out, you can
that
just do whatever you want.
That is not the case at all.
And I want people to hear this. Even the photographer who's top of his game or whatever. As Bill Fortney once said, there really aren't that many famous photographers or really rich photographers. Now, there are a couple of blips on there, but there's hustling photographers who are out there doing it, and they're making their mark, and they're living their dream shooting. And then there are people that are not.
That's
You're not sitting there. You don't see any retired photographers who are living on Easy Street.
No, you don't.
And so this is where we go back to the overcoming. This was your passion, and you
Absolutely.
Were getting, you were making it happen. And that's the thing. You come back to the whole idea is if it's your passion, you'll make it happen.
You have to. It's funny because it's not easy. People hear, oh, he did Kickstarter and he got the book done. That's not exactly true. It was hard the entire way through the project. It took 2.5 years to finish it, but even at the very end, it was difficult. And that's the universe testing you over and over again to see how badly you want a project to come to life. There were many times in this project where I wanted to quit, but I knew I could not, no matter what, for number one, to inspire these kids and other kids who looked like them. Also because I know that me finishing this project would inspire other photographers to make their dream come true. And that they all need to know that it's not easy. It's not supposed to be easy. It's supposed to be you making your dream come true no matter what it takes.
Well, and the thing that I hope you pull out of this is it's his heart and who he is. And we even talked about this. One of the reasons why he did his lighting setup, he lit every shoot.
Well, I want to ask, what kind of gear did you travel with when you did this? Because you said you're on the road for 2 to 3 weeks. You're driving yourself. What did you travel with?
Yes. Well, I had help driving as well. And there were points also where I even had an assistant help as well in terms of the gear. But it was always me carrying the gear. So I had Profoto strobes with me the entire way. I'd bring all my camera gear. I'd have Profoto strobes with me because I wanted to make sure I had a consistent look through every state. No matter if it was a cloudy day or rainy or overcast, whatever, I want that same fingerprint on the look. And also today, because anybody can take a picture with an iPhone or whatever, I want to differentiate my work from everything else out there by making sure that everything is lit in a professional way so it stands out and has a certain quality to it. So that was very important to me, that I had that same feeling from the first state to the last state. So every shot, every state, I'm dragging this gear around, you know, having my C-stands and carrying the gear and cameras around with me to make sure. And also making sure I had my light meter to my light everything, make sure I had that same formula of lighting in every state. So I can drop the sky down, make it more punchy. That's lighting and understanding how light works.
So did you have a van of gear? Did you have a trailer of gear?
No, actually.
Did you have an RV of gear?
Please tell me it was
slept
a beat
in
up
on
VW.
The road.
A Beetle.
No, so I'm thinking about that part also. Mm-hmm. How do I carry around not only gear, but posters? How do I get all this stuff in every state? So I'd fly into one place and I'd map out on the map where I was going to go and I'd rent a car. Sometimes it's a Prius. Which is actually kind of spacious, actually. And I fit all my gear into that. But I got to figure out how much can I carry, you know, safely with all my camera gear, all my lighting gear. And I did it. I used the same modifier.
You sure did. Yeah,
for every shot, I used the Profoto Magnum Reflector, which is one of my favorite light sources. I'm doing a workshop in Bahamas in a month. I'm going to take down that same gear to teach photographers how to do fashion photography, bringing down my own gear that I use to take this book.
Well, and I think one of the things that I like hearing you say is it was also you made the kids a star.
Absolutely. I want to talk about that for a second if I can.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. No, not at all.
The process of taking a picture is very special, it's precious. It's even more so for a child. If you have a situation where you make a child a star, you have lights, you have the parents, everybody around staring at them, they feel like how a celebrity feels today. Like, wow, I'm special. So it's the process of the photo shoot, that experience, that's also causing this special moment, this light bulb moment, And then marrying that experience with the idea of telling that child, you can be president one day, or anything else you want to be, is setting a moment in time for them to remember forever and influence their life.
Yeah.
Photography is special. It's a moment, frozen in time. And then, you know, a year later, 2 years later, they see themselves in this book. So now to have these books out and have these children see themselves in this book, that's special.
I know you said that some of the families you didn't even have a chance to talk to or hear what they thought about it until they saw it. And you had comments on Amazon, right? I mean, yes. You can order the book. We're going to give away 3 copies of the book here in just a minute after this next break.
3 special copies signed by Zendaya, the child star from Disney shows, and myself.
So we're going to give away 3 of those, and we're going to give away a subscription to MyLeo, an advanced subscription to MyLeo, which is going to be awesome.
Amazing.
Which is a big subscription.
But you can also get it on Amazon, right? I mean, and that's where you saw the words of some of the families that you actually
for the first time.
Captured.
It had me in tears. I'll admit, it had me in tears reading what the parents were saying.
How cool is that? That's just cool.
Right.
That's really cool.
Right. Okay, so let's take a quick break, and then when we come back, we're going to give away these books.
We all know the difference a great teacher makes. They inspire you, challenge you, and push you to do the things you never thought you could. For creatives, that means you've got to know your tools inside and out, whether it's Photoshop or photography, lighting or Lightroom, InDesign or After Effects. And while there are free videos out there, you have to watch 30 bad ones just to find a decent one. And a lot of times, the techniques are either outdated, complicated, or just plain wrong. What we need is a better way to learn. One that connects amazing teachers with creative people all over the world, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. A thriving educational community with nothing but the most talented, engaging, and respected teachers in the industry. Then we simplify the whole learning process with short, clear, concise classes. That's exactly what we've created for you right here at Kelby One.
And we are scrambling around here. Mia has got her. She's over there. She's directing. You can see the old newscaster coming up. She's like, I want over here. I want you over here. I need this over here. Hey, no, no, we're going to block this off. Don't you even think about starting that camera.
But you guys are so good at it.
Don't you even think about starting. Clock, stop right there.
Cut.
Are you ready? Are we good?
This is magical to see you guys at work.
We're going to try. We're going to try. And you know what? We're going to do it just like this. So we have the very first winner of our book today is Layton from... Layton, L-E-I-G-H-T-O-N. If your name is Layton, you have won
chat.
A book. And you're in the chat. You have won a book. A signed book. And so, congratulations. But you did not win the MyLeo subscription. We're going to get to that in a minute. The second winner of a book is Lonnie. Lonnie is from Utah. Congratulations, Lonnie. You get your own copy.
Yeah. Go Utah. Woo! Woo!
Did you? Hey, I bet you were in Utah at least once.
I want to go back over and over again. I love Utah. There are many states I want to go back to over and over again. Utah's one of those.
All right. Our final grand prize winner of the subscription, 1 year subscription to MyLeo, subscription and a book, is Jock Goodman from Hawaii.
That's Jock.
Jock. Jock Goodman from Hawaii.
Congrats, Jock.
So what we need is you guys to submit your details on the chat, and we'll go ahead and get those to you. Brandon will get in touch with you. He's running our chat right now.
Brandon is scrambling over there on the chat. We had a chat switch up, so Brandon's catching up. So they need to submit their details in the chat to Brandon and make sure he communicates with you. So even if the show finishes up, stay in the chat with him to make sure that we've got y'all covered. And we're going to have him sign all these, but I tell you what, since...
You should start now. Start signing now,
well,
just so you know
but
that
we want to make sure we got all the spellings and stuff.
That would make sense.
So we'll do that after the show, but he's going to sign them right here, and we're going to have those for you. So, yep, there you go. But also, Jock, you get the Mylio thing, that's the advanced subscription. And what that means with the advanced subscription is you can use it's a $250 value, but wait, there's more. You get a free set of wind chimes. No, but you can use it on up to 12 devices. You have multi-location capabilities, and you can upload up to 500,000 images. So you would have busted that out already.
Wow.
But that's what you get, Jock. And so now, because you won that, you're going to need to send me a ticket to come visit you.
Yeah.
In Hawaii.
So
actually, all of us, all three
we're
of us.
We're going to come set it up for you. Just send us the ticket right here.
Matthew will take your picture. It'll be all good. Thank you so much for being
on
the grid with us.
Pleasure.
You were such a great guest.
It went by way too fast, though.
It is. People don't believe how fast it goes up here. It's just like this.
It's like 10 minutes.
Yep. But, hey, you are a pleasure. Not only your photography, but just as a person, we've enjoyed hanging out with you today.
Absolutely.
And the great thing is Mia, you're going to do an interview series with them tomorrow, so it just keeps getting better.
I get to check you off of my inspirational interview list. We're going to do that tomorrow, and you'll be seeing that soon on the Kelby One site. You have to be a member to catch those, but...
Okay,
it's going to be a lot of fun.
And don't forget, coming up on March 19th, we're going to be doing the Photoshop 25th anniversary webcast.
Yes.
And we're going to be showing you some of the top 25 things that are going on in Photoshop. We've only got 8 days. Let's wait 5 seconds for 3, 2, 1. 8 days exactly from this moment.
That you can.
But that doesn't make sense because it's 5 o'clock now and it's at 7 p.m. Yeah, don't listen to that clock. It's all lies and rumors. But 7 p.m. on Eastern Standard Time on March 19th.
It's going to be live.
Make sure you check it out. It's going to be live. So you need to go over there and sign up, register. It'll be a great day. We'll have all of us up there dancing and singing and doing all kinds of good stuff.
Fantastic.
Live means anything can happen.
Anything can happen.
And it usually does.
All right, guys. Well, I'm Mia. That's Pete.
I'm Matthew Jordan Smith.
And he's got the great radio voice, Matthew Jordan Smith. And we're signing off. Goodbye, everybody. Take care.
Adios.
Bye.